oh Father, once again for this time where we are able to come and be with you. We thank thee, oh Father, for the opportunity that we had this morning to get up, to open up our eyes, and just to give God the glory, give you the glory. Then also, Father, for we are here this morning because we are here in a state of worship and of praise. And so, Father, we ask that you allow our hearts and our minds to be open to your guidance, open to your will. We also ask, Father, that you allow each and every one of us to take it in as you would want each and every one of us to take it, personally, so that we will understand what it is that you would have to say to each one of us. And on the other end of that, Father, we just ask that as we go out into the world today, that we are able to spread the good news of a heavenly Father, the good news about a gracious Savior, and one who came to save us so that we might be able to have eternal life. Yes, we thank you, and in your name we pray.
In your name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
So during this time of year, I have always been amazed at the evolution of ideas and how they take on further meanings as they develop across time. For many years, every time the end of the year comes around, we start thinking about a couple of things. For me, it's closing out the year and all types of other aspects. It's making sure my house is clean before going into a new year. Because my mother always taught me this. When you're going into a new year, you must have a clean house with some collard greens and some black-eyed peas. But the other thing that set on my mind, which was the New Year's resolution, what New Year's resolution was I going to have for this, going into a new year? For the past couple of years, I set one. And for those same past couple of years, I didn't speak it out loud because I just didn't want to be disappointed if I didn't live up to it. But now there's an oxymoron in the New Year's resolution because the word resolution just simply means that there's an end to something. It is as if you have already predicted the demise of an idea, or the notion that you're not going to be able to make this new change. You see, according to numerous historical outlets, books, and mediums, the history of the New Year's resolution begins with the Babylonians. The History Channel quotes itself that the ancient Babylonians are said to have been the first people to make New Year's resolutions some 4,000 years ago. They were also the first to hold the recorded celebrations in honor of the new year. And through them, the year began not in January, but in mid-March, when the crops were planted. But during a massive 12-day religious festival known as the Ikkidu, the Babylonians crowned a new king or reaffirmed their loyalty to the reigning king. They also made promises to the gods to pay their debts and to return any objects that had been borrowed. For these promises could be considered the forerunners of our New Year's resolutions. If the Babylonians kept to their word, their pagan gods would bestow favor on them for the coming year. If not, they would fall out of God's favor, a place no one wanted to be. But you have to see that the New Year's resolution today, in today's terms, takes on a dual definition, and the fact that someone wants to get rid of something while some want to start something anew. Most of the time, the new something is something they want in order to improve their lives. With that being said, it's the anticipation of what will come if I add this new piece into my life. Some of us make a resolution to lose weight. Some of us make a resolution to get our finances straight. Some of us make a resolution to decrease the drama that's in our lives. And some of us make a resolution to get rid of certain things in our lives that stop us from being healthy, such as smoking, drinking, gluttony. However, with whatever your resolution may be, what I often see is a failure to actually see it resolved. We try going cold turkey without even looking at what leads up to the fact that we are trying to correct. There's a failure to see that my diet or my lack of exercise has something to do with the reason why we're not losing weight. There's a failure to see that managing the money has something to do with the fact that we keep robbing Peter to pay Paul, and in some cases, Peter was broke before he even met up with Paul. There's a failure to see that as a part of managing the finances and getting the finances straight means that we must understand the importance of saving and the necessity to manage our buying habits. When we reach toward the resolution, we find that some steps we must take, that there's a process when it comes to change and growth. So this morning, I just want to take a few minutes to teach and preach to you on the subject of value added. During my college years, I took a class, two classes, microeconomics and a microeconomics class. I must admit I had to take one of them twice. Somewhere along the way, I learned about the whole concept of a value-added tax. It wasn't until I entered into the field of education and the influx and bombarding of the term value-added. So for the sake of our message today, I want to stick with the concept that is more related to the economic perspective of value added when it speaks about how much something is added to the actual existence of a product. You see, when we think about value added, we are thinking about something that is already added on to something. For example, some years ago, we were able to go up to our local McDonald's or your favorite fast food restaurant and just buy everything a la carte. But the emergence of meal deals gave a whole new perception and understanding of what it meant to have value added. Now we can go to McDonald's and we can get that Filet-O-Fish sandwich a whole lot cheaper if we just make sure we just get a meal. We get fries with it, we can get whatever drink with it, and it's cheaper than actually buying their sandwich, the fries, and the drink separately. There are more examples of value added that we find today, and this comes with the frequent buyer programs when you're going to the store and you get to get a percentage off if you use your frequent flyer cards. Some of us are still even using our frequent flyer airline program that encourages people to buy from certain companies or retailers in order to get more products or to get more off. Even if you go into a Best Buy today and purchase a computer or some level of technology, you might be able to receive some services from the Geek Squad. The Geek Squad is the one who comes out and fixes your computer when you haven't figured out how to turn it on. The one who fixes your computer when you haven't figured out what the hard drive is. But most recently on 60 Minutes, there was a story about the most popular value-added component of the holiday season. Anyone knows what the most value-added component is of the holiday season? What added so much value to the products this year? Free shipping. You're able to get free shipping. But now that I have, now just get to this for a minute, but now that I've talked about what it means to view value added from an economic perspective, what does value added really mean when we're talking about Christian growth process and going into a new year? You see, every year we could revisit the same message, the same passage, and every year it will have a different meaning to you if you are truly growing at the process that God would expect you to be at. You see, for each year, you should be able to look back over your journey and understand where there has been some value that has been added along the way. So with that in mind, there are only two things that I want to take a few minutes to just discuss today and help us to recollect over our journey this past year and move forward into the new year. Have you ever thought that God has a New Year's resolution for you? One thing that's involved that you're growing in your relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. Take a look at the neighbor who you haven't spoken to in a long time. Ask him this question. Are you growing?
Are you growing?
Are you growing? So it's a personal story. At the age of 13, this was an essential question that was asked of me quite a bit. And it was funny, it was a long-going joke for the longest time because my family are a family of short people. I'm average in my family. When Mark and I got married and we took our wedding pictures, you could very well see who is whose family. He was the tallest in the picture of my family, and I clearly, the line went just like this for his family. But there was something very interesting around the age of 13 that came up for me, and that came through a physical that happened at school. And the physical said that I had a curvature in my spine. And so I went through a series of battles of going back and forth because it all had something to do with the spine, which then had something to do with my legs, which still had something to do with my feet and everything like that. It was at age 13 that they diagnosed me with scoliosis. We didn't exactly know what that was all about. But we found out that it was a curvature of the spine, which added some meaning and added some value to my understanding of why I had a shoulder that always seemed to drop lower than the other one. Why I couldn't necessarily wear jackets and look normal. Never had a whole lot of back pain. But I remember the doctor specifically said to me, she's not gonna grow any more than this because of that. And I kind of, for a while at age 13, I said, I'm not gonna get any taller than this. But this was it. I didn't get any taller because this is where I stopped at age 13. But sometimes we have to ask ourselves the question, is there something that's going to give us pause and cause not to grow in the way in which we should? In the way that which is intended for us. Because we have to realize that sometimes when we struggle with growth, we have to realize that growth is very complex. Today, as we reach toward the letter that Paul writes to the Philippians, it is a familiar passage to those who spend some reasonable amount of time within the pews of the church, and to others who see this as a fresh new look as we go into 2020. You see, this passage in Philippians has become known as the Christian growth process. But this is where Paul tries to educate early believers about what it means to grow and to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. He paints the picture about how to reach the goal through the process of growing as a believer in Christ. See, there's two things that I'm going to talk about here. The first thing is we must have the proper attitude. Say attitude.
Attitude.
Say attitude.
Attitude.
See, Paul had one primary goal, and that was to grow in his knowledge of Jesus Christ. But we find this particular goal in verses 7 through 11 in the same chapter. But it is also in this passage that Paul reminds us that in order for us to run toward the ultimate goal of having a rich relationship with Jesus Christ and to obtain the greatness of knowing who Jesus really is, we must experience some level of our own personal crucifixion. See, we're going to have to leave something behind. Some of us are stuck in our own heyday. Now, for our young people here, you may not know that yet because you might be living in it, but there are some of us that are stuck in our own heyday. My mother had a friend, and I remember him well. I won't call his name out because some of y'all may know him. But he was stuck in the 1970s. He had the bell bottoms all the way into the 2000s, and they were tight on it, too. They were tight. Polyester, white shoes, the big afro, the shirt that had the big collars.
Big collar.
He was stuck in his heyday for 40 years. But I really enjoyed him. He knew who he was, but he was stuck in a heyday. Some of us are still stuck in our heyday. I was with somebody a couple of weeks ago. I can't remember what generation it was. We were talking about what was the thing that was in at the time. What were we wearing at the time? We were talking about, I think I was with some young people because they were cracking on us. Because we were talking about FUBU. We were talking about Vanderbilt. We were talking about the best things ever being worn at that time, the big medallions and stuff like that, that we saw Public Enemy that was wearing. That's I'm telling you now, that's my heyday. Is that we were able to wear those things then. But then we realized something about our heyday. Is your heyday is when you said life was good, but life was good and life was foul. You tried everything and everything tried you. And if we put ourselves in the shoes of Paul, we can still both dwell on his mistakes and let them ruin his life and his chance for effective ministry if he stayed in his heyday. Or he could forget about them and move on with his life. Just like Paul had to make a choice, so do we as well. Maybe you've had a bad experience just lately, or maybe you've done something long ago that you cannot regret. Maybe the memories keep coming back to you to haunt you from living a full life today. And sometimes when you end up in the company of one of those saints who has a worldly and confused gift of having a memory like an elephant, they don't forget nothing. Not letting God take over your growth process. But see, here's one thing we have to remember. Forgetting does not mean getting rid of the memories of the past, but it's a constant refusal to let those memories absorb your attention and to stop your progress. The separation of what you have lived and witnessed and gained this position in Christ can be a hard fight to battle. Since some of the things that we fight is oftentimes things that we believe in. When we add value added to our attitude, it's about taking a look at the battle that we have been fighting from the spectator's seat. It's about looking at the unnecessary things in our life that we need to let go. It's about looking at the toxic relationships that have added weight to our very being. It's about the anger, frustration, and being and having this thought process that I just need to be unforgettable because we have carried an unforgiving spirit. You see, many people zero in on one good period in their life, and they spend the rest of their lives trying to relive that past. Saying, don't you remember the good old days when so-and-so was still here? It's one thing that I hear a lot of today is this, and folks, when folks say like, man, I'm glad I am not a teenager today.
Wow.
And I think about when we were teenagers, and I remember that some of my parents, my mother's and my father's friends would say just this, man, I'm glad I'm not a teenager today. They say it in every generation, not realizing that that's their time. You start thinking about, and that maybe it was in high school or college or when you first got married or when your kids were young and et cetera. As well, some of us who gain an opinion of something stays with that opinion so long that they don't even understand the relevance or the root of the thought. Surprising enough, this is the same temptation that Christians and the church give into as well. So many times I've heard people say, remember the good old days when we used to do this at church? When so-and-so was still here, or how they could pray, or how they could sing? Remember when we did this and that and so forth and so on? One weird thing we know of for certain, God never consults your past in order to determine your future.
Mm-hmm.
He don't look back at it like you do. And when we leave something behind, we strive closer to understanding the power of the resurrection. The power that's involved with going through the suffering and the power of experiencing new life. For Paul's goal was to acquire complete knowledge of knowing who Jesus Christ really is. He wanted to know his smell. He wanted to know his aroma. He wanted to know his touch. He wanted to experience his love. See, some of us are so worried about knowing who Jesus Christ was from a theological perspective. When you just know him from that perspective, you know that it's no different than us knowing who the presidents were in history books. We know what style of leadership they had. But for others who want to grow and who want to grow in the wisdom of Jesus Christ, it's going to involve understanding, suffering, and it's going to mean the power of resurrection. You see, sometimes you have to pray for deliverance. You have to crave for a resurrection, and you must crave a breakthrough for yourself. See, in the new year, we need to make it personal. In John 14, 13 and 14, he tells us when Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this drink will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the drink I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. and 13. He said, Jesus answered, again, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. Jesus offers those that believe the promise to quench the thirst and to satisfy the craving. But sometimes we trust in God, but we don't trust in ourselves. It's time to check yourself at the door. So the second thing is going into the new year. It's going with the attitude and the desire of knowing what's what. Say, what's what?
What's what? What's what?
Verse 16 tells us that we have to begin with the end in mind. Instead of reaching for the impossible, let me challenge you today that to know what is possible through him who knows and has a relationship with Jesus Christ. When I was in college, one of the things that I always enjoyed doing is that was going to the dances and actually doing the hand dancing. I enjoy hand dancing. And I came home and I asked my mother, because I never really saw my parents dance, and I said, could you just show me how to hand dance? So she showed me what she knew about hand dance. And anybody who knows anything about hand dancing, you know that there's a how many count?
Four.
There's a four count. We got some hand dancers in here. So it was a four count that takes place. They're in there. So I imagine this is my partner. He's going to stand here for a minute and so forth and so on. But you go back and forth. One, two, three, four, you touch. One, two, three, four, you touch. One, two, three, four, touch. One, two. I'm doing a lot now, right? One, two, three, four, touch. So, if there were certain people at the University of Akron, when a song came on, there was only like two people who I could actually dance with because we had the same rhythm. So when the song came on, wasn't nobody I was dating or nothing like that. He said, come on, let's go. So we knew exactly. We knew how to stay in rhythm with the touch. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four.
Got some music. I got a partner.
I'm sure. But that's the one thing that happens when we start to have a rich relationship with Jesus Christ, is we actually know how to hand dance and to get into the same rhythm. Because God's going to find that rhythm, and Christ is going to have that rhythm that is just for you. When you give your thinking over to Christ, you are setting yourself up to be enlightened. And when you commit yourself to that foundation, you are going to find some harmony and some rhythm. And with that harmony, you will find yourself in sync with Jesus Christ in an attitude that is cultivated by God. Because if I ever was, I tried it a couple of times with some people who did not exactly know what it meant to be the one, two, three, four, and we were off for the entire song. I couldn't even appreciate it. Because then I fell into it that I gotta follow him like a lot of women do. They try to follow the man, even though the man may be off. I've gone too far while I try to help you. If I had to make it really plain, you will have to find that the way that you think is no longer yours, but rather the thinking of God. And you will find that your actions are no longer yours, but they are what Jesus Christ would do. Every year, he stayed the course. We add value to our journey, as Paul writes, and gain knowledge of Jesus Christ. I'm reminded of a story of a grocery store owner who overheard a young boy who was using the payphone, at the entrance of his store. You know how telephone conversations go. You usually hear one side of the conversation. The young boy was talking, and the store manager was listening. He said, hello, sir, I was calling you to see if you could use a lawn boy to use your car, to use a lawn boy to do your yard work. I see, you already have one. Well, is he doing your work to your satisfaction? Oh, he is. Thank you, sir. I was just checking. Then a young boy hung the phone up. The grocery store owner looked at the boy and said, sorry, you didn't get the job. Oh, no, sir, said the boy. I already had the job. I was just calling to check on myself. See, sometimes sometimes as a Christian, we are constantly in need of taking our own self inventory. Mm-hmm. And what a wonderful way we look at it when we look at this text every year is to go back and see, are we up to the task? In order to have a winning Christian attitude, a person must have a dissatisfaction with his or her life. Oh, you didn't hear that one. You cannot be satisfied with what your life is at all times. In order for you to have a winning Christian attitude, you must be at some point where you're dissatisfied with parts of your life. You see, that may sound strange, but in order to turn to the Lord, a person must be dissatisfied with the status quo and be willing to have a change of heart. There's one thing we also know, and this is where we can be faithful and find our faith, is that if we fall off, and maybe the value added has become stagnant or unmoved, or maybe you have fallen behind, God reassures us that it's never too late to get back in the race. In Philippians 3:17, it says, join together and follow my examples, brothers and sisters, and just as I have used us as a model, keep your eyes on those who live as we do. Paul challenged the Philippians to pursue the goal to be Christ-like by following Paul's own living example. By no means does this mean to copy exactly what you see. But as you focus and as he focused his life on being Christ-like, that is what we should be. And that is what we should do. There's a story about a mother and a father who were awakened one night by a loud noise from their son's bedroom. As they were rushing into their son's room, they found their son had fallen out of bed. Confronted by his parents, the little boy said, I guess I fell asleep too close to where I got in. He said, I fell asleep too close to where I got in. See, that can be a commentary for many of us today on our own spirituality. Fall asleep too close to the place that we entered into our personal relationship with Jesus Christ. See, the Apostle Paul lost his old life of sin and he gained a new life in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He was dissatisfied with who he was, but he became very satisfied with his salvation. Yet he has never not been satisfied with his personal walk. Because if you have really done your personal walk and entered your journey, there has been some growth. And each year, if you stick to it, there's some value added. Paul was aware of his need to go deeper in his walk with the Lord. Never permitted himself to become content. And as we make our promises to ourselves, we are going to have to remind ourselves on a daily basis that some things we are going to have to work at. We're going to have to work at it. From growing our knowledge of who Jesus Christ is and how he came to save us all must be humble to the sacrifice and the process. As a Christian, it is imperative and it is mandatory that we grow and we progress spiritually. I repeat that there are going to be some things that we are going to have to work at. Mind it in that verse again, tells us to keep pressing toward the goal. And as you press toward the goal, you have to suffer some heartache. You're going to suffer some headaches, some backaches, some hurt feelings, some desperation. And sometimes you're going to question, how am I going to get through this?
Amen.
How am I going to make it? You see, I often find myself repeating the words of my mother when she would say, Lord, help me along this way. When you will begin to question all of those who are around you, and you may even experience what we call some spiritual paranoia, always wondering, is it worth it? You're going to find yourself snuggling up with worry and having lunch dates with fear, dinner dates with discontent, and midnight snacks with doubt. But as I just stop by here for a few more minutes as we say goodbye to 2019 and say hello to 2020, Paul tells us in verse 12, not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. However, it will help me to shift my motivation into verse 14 when he says, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Jesus Christ. Paul was devoted to one thing, and the one thing was serving Christ. So we as Christians, we as body of believers in the church, we must have a new direction, moving our faith, moving forward in our faith, and not concentrating on our past or anybody else's past, unless the past is the key to your future spiritual growth. See, after becoming a Christian, Paul only looked back to see the things that he had accomplished or suffered for Christ. So it's good sometimes to look back, because the past keeps us focused upon what we might expect in the future. So as I get ready to take my seat, in the most recent years or so, there has been another contemporary way of setting goals. In addition to the making New Year's resolutions, there has been a series of events and day parties that have popped up all over the country during this time of year and into January that are called Vision Board Parties. Yesterday, I had the opportunity to participate in one, and I created my own individual and personal vision board. Listen to me. As a child, I would create them, and not realizing exactly what I was doing, because I wasn't at that point where I understood it. I was trying to grow. I found myself dibbling and dabbling with pictures, and most of the time they were pictures that were attractive to me, but I later found out that they were pictures of myself that I was trying to achieve. You see, the primary goal of the vision board party is not simply just to sit around and have conversation and drink on pop and drink on whatever this or that. It's not just to cut out some pictures, but it's also to have that opportunity to see this as a growth process, to visualize where it is that you want to be. It's setting goals, it's painting a picture, it's finding hope in the future. It requires the individual to look back and to assess where they were so that they can make a determination of where they want. The board will be some pictures, some words, some symbols as you visualize yourself. It is your vision of where you want to be in the greatness that God puts you in. Mm-hmm. To be quite transparent with you, as I was sitting there yesterday and grounding myself in this event, I found myself struggling. I did. I found myself struggling. And I found myself struggling with what my vision was going to be and what it was going to look like. I think a lot of us struggle with that. What is it going to be? What is it going to look like? So many of us still struggle with just getting by day, night by night. But I realized there, sitting there, I did have to do something. I couldn't just sit there. So I went into a prayer, thought about what is it that God would want it to look like. So I had no idea what it was going to look like at the end. But after I prayed to God and I asked him, tell me, give me some direction. This is where we ended up. So because of the struggle, I had to pause, said this prayer, and he would give this vision. See, if you are stuck in a place today, if there is something that is stopping you from creating your own board, pray, because it adds value. Is there something that is blocking you from having a vision? If you are struggling with clarity simply because you are refusing to press on you in your progress, or you're being stymied because you just don't know how to do it. Sometimes we just have to sit and wait on God's will to be done. And in doing so, surrender your heart and press on still toward the goal, knowing that your process is about growth and it's about growing in your knowledge of Jesus Christ. So if I have to be quite frank with you today, there's some of us that are still standing here because you're saying that my reason why I'm not growing in Jesus Christ or growing in my knowledge is because you want to give it all to somebody else. That's my reason. When you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, it's personal. That's your relationship with Jesus Christ. Part of looking back and leaving it behind. Is this because you're the one who's trying to press toward the goal? Don't give it all to somebody else.
Amen.
Because the sad part is giving it all to somebody else, I bet you that person is moving on. And they're recognizing that I got to move on. See, it's about healing. It's about hope. It's about adding value to your journey. There's an African-American spiritual by the name of Keep Your Hand on the Plow. Here's our historians. We're looking at one. Al. See another one back there. Keep Your Hand on the Plow. You see, this lyrics would say, hold on, hold on, keep your hand on the plow, hold on. Heard the voice of Jesus say, come unto me, I am the way. Mm-hmm. Keep your hand on the plow, hold on. Mm-hmm. When my way gets dark at night, I know the Lord will be my light. Mm-hmm. Keep your hand on the plow, hold on. When I get to heaven, gonna sing and shout. Be nobody there to put me out. Mm-hmm. Keep your hand on the plow. Hold on. I know my robe's gonna fit me well. I tried it on at the gates of hell. Mm-hmm. Keep your hand on the plow. Hold on. You see, that spiritual referred to those who was determined, determined to live a Christian life.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And what they would expect in the process. But let me bring it just up to you just a little today. It's a later adaptation in that spiritual adaptation. And some of you may know it was entitled, Keep Your Eyes on the Prize. See, that version, which was birthed out of the civil rights movement, was grounded in the Philippians 3 passage with a reminder of the race that we must run. For its lyrics would say, Paul and Silas, bound in jail, had no money for you to go there, babe. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. Mark and Vicky struggling every day. Al and Greg ain't found no way.
Pray for our memory day.
Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. Paul and Silas began to shout. Doors popped open and they walked out. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. Somebody told me that I wasn't going to be worth 2 cents. But my God says, you all are heaven sent. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. We're the only chains that we can stand are the chains of hand in hand. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. Got my hand on the plow of freedom. Wouldn't take nothing from my journey now. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. Let us pray. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we just thank you once again. For Father, you have brought us this far in 2019. And so Father, we just ask right now for those things that we are ready to just leave behind so that we can press on and move forward. So sometimes, Father, we have to realize in order for our journey to be more productive, we're going to have to let some stuff go. So, Father, we just ask right now for those things that are holding us down because we are ready to press on toward the goal. Father, help us to keep our eyes on the prize and help us to hold on. And in doing so, Father, we know that there's somebody amongst us today that we want to embrace as a brother and sister in Christ, looking for Jesus, looking for that relationship. Father, we ask now that you just give them what they need so that they will grow even closer to you. Understanding that in this struggle, in this world as a Christian, we we don't suffer. But because of that, we understand the sacrifice. We understand the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. Father, equip each and every one of us as we go back out of this place today, so that we can continue to spread the good news to someone who's ready to let go. We can tell them that every day of your journey, not just every day of your life, but every day of your journey that you walk toward being in knowledge of Christ, having a relationship with Jesus Christ, every day of your journey, you will have value added. We thank you, Father. And in your name we pray. Amen. Our hymn of invitation is number one, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. We want to invite all who want to come this morning. If you are feeling called to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, we invite you to come. If you are feeling called to join this body of believers, or if you are in need of prayer this morning, we invite